Hi, and welcome to today's history lesson. Today we'll be looking at factors for growth of African nationalism. We'll be looking at what nationalism is, what nationalism isn't, what causes nationalism, and how Africa was actually able to use this feeling of nationalism to liberate itself. So first, let's talk about nationalism. What is nationalism? Nationalism is a feeling of devotion and loyalty towards a country. It is what we call in Swahili uzalendo, kuwa mzalendo wa taifa lako. It means you love your country and you are ready to fight for it and to ensure that it prospers. In that regard, let's look at what nationalism is on the context of Africa. Nationalism can be defined as the desire for Africans to end all forms of foreign control and influence so as to be able to take charge of their political, social and economic affairs. Before 1960, most of Africa was still under colonial control. It means that they were not able to do what they wanted. They had to receive order and a sort of acceptance or approval from the higher authority so that they can do things their own way. Now, this did not please a lot of Africans because they felt that they deserved the right to do the things the way they want, anyhow they want, anytime they want, without having to seek approval from somebody who is not even African in the first place, let alone be a member of that community. Before 1960, most of Africa was still under colonial control. However, by 1970, most of Africa was independent of European colonialism. Now, several factors contributed to this point of African nationalism. One is the loss of independence to foreigners and the introduction of foreign system of governance. It means that the way they used to do things, the way they used to govern themselves, the way they used to live is no longer allowed. Now that is not something they could stand because they felt you cannot just come from where you're from and instruct us on how we should live because this is how we have been living for years. And so because of that they felt, no, we need these people to live. We need these people to leave our country. In addition to this, there was unfair colonial policies. Now this includes policies such as taxation, forced labor and compulsory growing of crops that caused discontent among Africans. This last part is important, this compulsory growing of crops. What this means is that the Africans were forced to grow crops that the masters felt were more important. And you must know by now that the way colonial masters worked, they restricted some certain regions to only farm some certain type of crops because they were more beneficial. So if you are in Tanga, for example, you are restricted to only growing sisal. And if you're in Mtwara, you are only restricted to grow cashew nuts. And they felt this is unfair. But on top of that, they were also heavily taxed. They had to pay taxes for almost everything. This, in the end of the day, resulted into the living condition whereby they earn little money, and even that little money they earn, it is still taken away from them. And because of that, they felt that these people need to leave and they needed to take control of their country. There are different ways in which Africans showed this. The suffering of Africans was expressed in form of armed resistance in many countries, and this marked the growth of nationalism. But apart from that, there is also the settlement of large numbers of European settlers in different parts of Africa. Now this caused the growth of nationalism in the sense that large number of Africans were displaced from their fertile lands in Kenya, Zimbabwe, Tanzania, South Africa and many other countries. This caused destruction of African culture, it caused poverty, it caused hunger and other forms of suffering. It also exposed Africans to segregation. There were places where Africans were not allowed to enter. There were hospitals that Africans were not allowed to be treated at. And so this caused the need to fight for political freedom and self-determination. Now, apart from that, there is also the emergence of new superpowers. It is at this time that USA and Soviet Union, which is now known as Russia, had replaced Britain, France and Germany, which had failed to protect the world peace. Now, these new superpowers wanted to protect their interest in Africa, and so they wanted to be free to pursue their trading interests and as a result to spread the ideology of capitalism. Russia also wanted to spread communism. As a result of this, they therefore put pressure on colonial powers to decolonize. In addition, they provided support to liberation movements, for example, scholarship for African students. they also used their influence to UN to call for independence of African colonies. This encouraged the growth of African nationalism. Also important to note was the improved transport network and urbanization. Improved transport led to concentration of people in few areas such as mining centers or the places where cash crops were being grown, processing areas and port cities. Now this in turn caused urbanization. Now urbanization is whereby a town turns into a more urban area. It means it is more developed with better communications and infrastructure. Now many people from different ethnic groups migrated to towns. People of different cultural backgrounds shared their experiences. They suffered the same problems of racial discrimination, unemployment, poor living conditions. This is something that they noticed. The moment they came together, the moment they started talking, that's when they realized, hey, you are also suffering the same thing that I'm suffering. And so why don't we unite together and fight this thing, because it is our common enemy. And as a result, they decided that they should unite and fight for political independence, and they did. Apart from that, there is also colonial education. Now this contributed to rise of African nationalism in the following way. As a result of colonial education, that is the education that was given to Africans during colonial period, a group of African elites with anti-colonial sentiment emerged. These educated Africans later became leaders of nationalistic movements. They played a decisive role in the mobilization of their people for political independence. People like Kwame Nkrumah, Jomo Kenyatta, Modibo Keita, Mamadou Dia, among others, they resulted into the very leaders that later on used that education to inspire Africans to fight for their independence, which again, they did. Of particular importance was Mahatma Gandhi's strategy of non-violence. Now, this is whereby Mahatma Gandhi, this is the freedom fighter for India, decided that they are not going to use violence as a means to attain their independence. This was borrowed by Nkrumah, who called it positive action. It involved political campaigns, education, newspapers, boycotts, and strikes. African nationalists decided to use this strategy. Apart from that, there is also the role that Asia played in the growth of African nationalism. The independence of states like India and Pakistan in 1947 encouraged Africans to also struggle for political independence. This is the same way that if you see your fellow peer has been able to achieve a certain score in their exams, you also feel like, hey, maybe I can achieve that score too. Now, it's the same thing that happens with Africans. They saw that India and Pakistan had already achieved self-determination. They had already decolonized themselves, and so they felt that we can achieve too. Now, another thing that led to African nationalism and the growth of it is the influence of Liberia and Ethiopia. These are the only two states in Africa that were never colonized. The presence of independent states of Liberia and Ethiopia showed that it is actually possible for Africans to rule their own countries. This influenced nationalistic movements. Another thing that influenced the African nationalism are the Pan-African movements. Now, Pan-African congresses, which were held in the first half of the 20th century, emphasized the need to promote the dignity of black people and liberate them from racial discrimination. They emphasized the idea of Africa for Africans. Of a particular importance was the first ever Pan-African Congress, which was held in Manchester in 1945. In 1945, this conference took place in Manchester. It was attended by key figures like Kwame Nkrumah and Jomo Kenyatta. The Congress resolved that Africans must organize liberation movements to free Africa from foreign control. This encouraged the rise of African nationalism. And linked to this was the work of Organization for African Unity, the OAU. Now, the OAU supported the liberation struggle by providing diplomatic and military support. The OAU Liberation Committee, with headquarters in Dar es Salaam under the leadership of Julius Nyerere, inspired and supported nationalistic movements in Mozambique, Angola, Namibia, South Africa, Zimbabwe, among other countries. Also linked to this is the formation of political parties. Now, these political parties inspired nationalism in the sense that they sensitized colonial people about their rights and especially the need for political independence. It raised awareness to people that you're not supposed to be treated this way. These people have no right to treat you this way. And so people became more aware of their rights, and because of that, they joined these parties, and as a result, their movement became bigger and bigger, and the demand for political independence grew higher and higher and higher. Examples of the parties include CCP in Ghana, TANU in Tanzania and other parties like KANU in Kenya. It is also important to note the contribution of African nationalists. Now, we have mentioned them throughout this video, but we haven't actually taken time to acknowledge their contribution. People like Kwame Nkrumah, Patrice Lumumba, Abdel Nasser, among others, provided leadership in mobilization which encouraged the emergence of nationalists all over Africa.
Now that African independence has been achieved over a large part of the continent, and the national consciousness of Africans from north to south, from east to west, is adding momentum to the struggle for independence. Every kind of means is being used by the colonialists to arrest its progress and defeat its objective.
Another person is Harold Macmillan, who also played an important role. As a result of powerful nationalist movements in Africa, on one of his visits to Africa, he made the famous speech called The Wind of Change. He observed that a wind of change was sweeping through Africa and that colonial powers had to leave Africa to avoid fighting. This encouraged the demand for independence. Another thing was the political party in Britain, so specifically the Labour Party in 1945. The Second World War led to death, destruction of buildings and other properties. As a result, the Conservative Party of Winston Churchill was replaced by the Labour Party led by Clement Attlee. The Labour Party was determined to grant independence to British colonies, hence the rise of African nationalism. Lastly, religion also played an important role. The growth of Ethiopian movement, which was a religion by the way that was inspired by biblical references, told people that Africa and black people would dominate the world politically, socially and economically. It started in South Africa in 1892 and spread to West Africa. Whether this was true or not, this actually encouraged the plight of black people and inspired the feelings of nationalism. That's it for today. Thanks for watching the video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Visit myelimu.com to get more content like this and also interact with other students. Until another time, bye-bye.